Everyone who participated, to all our volunteers that ran the games and the booths, Cheryl and friends, the Hunter family, the Diaz family, the Greenhill family, all the Vassberg family, Romo family, the Lasswick family, we have Terry Gala, Oliver, Henry, William, Winston, Susan, Lonnie, Breyer, Bella, Patty Marsden, the Hugo family, friends, and we also had Glenn Wilkie, and we also had Roberta out there. We had a whole house pulled out there helping out. We even had some cake walkers over here. I remember that right here. They won two cakes, actually. So all the women who brought cookies and cakes for the cake walk, it was a hit, and some people even purchased some of the cakes to take home. So it was a blast. And to all the guys who made those burgers and all the food, they practically sold out of all the burgers, so that was a hit as well. The Model A made people stop and take pictures, and we did see a lot of different pictures on Facebook. So since they were in part of the church, our church is out there all over the place right now, so that's a good thing. And a big thank you to anyone that we may have forgotten, but overall thank you to everyone who made it possible, and let's do it again. And I would like to thank everyone also for staying and helping clean up, because that made it a very quick process. So we were actually able to get home kind of at a decent time, even though we didn't make the church, but I was tired. All right, let's go ahead and get started with today's announcement. church council accepted a bid to repair and paint the outside of the parsonage office building, and I did talk to him this week. He will probably get started sometime the coming week. He'll start pressure washing, and then he'll start replacing all the wood, and then he'll start the caulking and paint. So hopefully, maybe by next week, it'll be done. So that's his plan here. Next week is All Saints Sunday on November 5th. We will light candles for friends and family that we have lost since November 6th of last year. Please fill out the insert with your loved one's information and give it to Patty. November 19, 2023 has been designated as EMR Sunday. There will be a potluck luncheon following the service that morning. EMR letters were included with the copy of the Constitution given out on 10/15/23. And Bethel will have another movie day on Saturday, November 4th at 3 o'clock p.m. We plan to watch the 2007 movie August Rush. It is a story about a 10-year-old musical prodigy. If you would like to serve as lectors, there is a sign-up sheet in the narthex. Remember that we are gospel people who live the gospel life. Do we have any other announcements? Oh, wait, and one more. Bethel will host our second annual Trunk or Treat event in front of the church Tuesday, October 31st from 5 to 7 p.m. And everyone is welcome to participate, but it is going to be cold, so bundle up because it's going to be windy and cold. So we'll see what happens. If anything happens or we may reschedule or anything, we will let everybody know. But as far as right now, we are on for Tuesday from 5 to 7. So please bring blankets or whatever you might need to stay warm, because I don't want any of y'all getting sick.
The insert for All Saints, we forgot to put it in again this week. So Brian's going to get them, and we'll have them in the back if you need one.
Okay, if you need an insert, they will be in the back after church. Do we have any other announcements?
The photos of the festival are posted in the parish hall
and the entrance. Yes, we have entrance here in the entrance and at the parish hall. And they are a nice collage of the photos. There's some pretty funny ones with the body getting flies from the face. So there's a couple of William Mystery shots on the beanbag. Can't win them all, buddy. And do we have any other announcements? Alright, let's go ahead and get started with the Lord is in His Holy Temple.
To the glory of your holy name. Amen. mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for you. And for his sake, God forgives you all your sins. To those who believe in Jesus Christ, he gives the power to become the children of God, and he bestows on them the Holy Spirit. Amen. Our gathering hymn this morning is found on page 230, Lord, Keep Us Steadfast in Your Word, 230.
Thank you.
class. It is Pastor's birthday today, so we would all like to give her a happy birthday, if that's okay.
First reading is from the 31st chapter of Jeremiah. The days are surely coming, says the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and the house of Judah. It will not be like the covenant I made with their ancestors when I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt. The covenant that they broke while I was their husband, says the Lord. But this is the covenant I will make with the house of Israel after those days, says the Lord. I will put my law within them. I will write it on their hearts. I will be their God, and they shall be my people. No longer shall they teach one another or say to each other, know the Lord, for they shall all know me, from the least of them to the greatest, says the Lord. For I will forgive their iniquity and remember their sin no more. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Psalm 46, we'll read responsibly. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble.
Therefore we will not fear, though the earth be moved, and though the mountains be toppled to the depths of the sea.
Though as waters rage from foam, and through the mountains tremble with tumult.
The Lord of hosts is with us, the God of Jacob is our stronghold.
There is a river whose streams make glad the city of God, the holy habitation of the Most High.
God is in the midst of her, she shall not be overthrown. God shall help her as she prays to him.
The nations make much ado, and the kingdoms are shaken. God has spoken, and the earth shall melt away.
The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our stronghold.
Come now, and look upon the works of the Lord. What an awesome thing he has done on earth.
It is he who makes war to cease in all the world. He breaks the bow. He shatters the spear, and burns the shields with fire.
Be still then, and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth.
The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our stronghold.
Second reading is from the third chapter of Romans. Now we know that whatever the law says, it speaks to those who are under the law, so that every mouth may be silenced, and the whole world may be held accountable to God. For no human being will be justified in his sight by deeds prescribed by the law. For though the law comes, for through the law comes the knowledge of sin. But now, apart from the law, the righteousness of God has been disclosed and is attested by the law and the prophets. The righteousness of God through faith in Jesus Christ for all who believe, for there is no distinction, since all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. They are now justified by His grace as a gift through the redemption of that is Christ Jesus, whom God put forward as a sacrifice of atonement by His blood, effecting it through faith. He did this to show His righteousness, because in His divine forbearance He had passed over the sins previously committed. It was to prove at the present time that He Himself is righteous, and that He justifies the one who has faith in Jesus. Then what becomes of boasting? It is excluded. By what law? And that of works? No, but by the law of faith. For we hold that a person is justified by faith apart from works prescribed by the law. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God. So if the Son makes you free, you will be free indeed. Word of God, word of life. This is the gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
He was very much against a saying that was popular in those days. As soon as the coin is in the coffer rings, a soul from purgatory springs. In other words, the church was saying that if family or friends could pay a nice sum of money to the church, they would get their loved ones out of purgatory. Martin Luther insisted that forgiveness was God alone to grant, and those people who claimed that indulgences absolved anyone from punishment and granted them salvation were in error. Christians, he said, must not slacken in following Christ on account of these false assurances. Martin Luther set out to be a priest, not a reformer. When he nailed these 95 theses to the door of the Castle Church in Wittenberg, Germany, his only desire was to debate issues facing the church of his day. One person standing for truth and one person standing for truth now can make a big difference. Just think of the changes that took place after he did this. Luther also believed that the Word of God needed to be read in all homes. So when the printing press was invented in 1517, Luther's translation of the Bible into German was made accessible to all German families. In 1530, over 10,000 publications were known with a total of 10 million copies. The Reformation was thus a media revolution and the start of the Lutheran Church. So, change came about. He had no idea as a young boy, but he brought about change. Said, I talked to my neighbor the other day while I was walking my two dogs. He just returned from a mission trip to Mexico. He was a missionary over there for years. Now he's retired, but he still goes back periodically to preach and have studied with different people. He said something he would never have dreamed of happened on his trip. And I asked him to share it with me, and he went on to explain that just as the plane that he was on was getting ready for takeoff, they were told to sit down and wait. A bomb had exploded nearby, and the crew was ordered to search every compartment in the plane before taking off. He was in a state of shock. He never expected anything like that to happen while flying in Mexico. But surprises do come into our lives. Imagine this scene. You're in a doctor's office, and the doctor comes in and tells you your heart is severely damaged and you will surely die without a transplant. I placed your name on a waiting list, and in a few months we'll schedule a surgery. And when it's over, God willing, you're going to be healed. No more gasping for breath when you walk across the room. No more shooting pains. You'll be your own self again, only better. Your mind is reeling with this news. There's so many questions you want answered. Partly because the doctor didn't explain it all, and partly you didn't listen very well either. Patiently, the doctor walks you through what is going to come, and eventually the day you dread and hope for arrives. Get to the hospital, we have a new heart for you. But late at night, or maybe a few days later, as you wait for the pain medication to kick in or for the anti-rejection drugs to reduce a fever, there in the silent room, you even have more questions. As you lay there, you think, whose heart is in my body? Was it a man or was it a woman? What was its race? Did he or she have a religion, and what was it? Did they work, and what kind of job were they involved in? How did this person live, and how did he or she die? What does it mean that you bear a living portion of another person's body there within your chest? What does it mean that you live only because another person died and allowed part of his or her body to be given to a stranger? How will you be changed, just not by that surgical procedure, but by this astonishing and deeply intimate gift that will beat within your chest for the rest of your natural life? What will it be like to live knowing that each breath you take, each word you speak, each thought and gesture and action is possibly only because of this new heart, a gift from a stranger powering your body? You share some of these questions with the doctor, and you're assured that no, you're not suddenly going to start watching old movies that he or she seemed to like. In fact, your body is constantly going to be rejecting this new heart, deeming it an alien, dangerous. Only the anti-rejection drugs you take will allow the new heart to become an integral part of your own body. Perhaps the doctor was right. This heart transplant has allowed you to be your own self again. Another scenario could be, you come to church with your new baby and you hear disturbing words. Your baby's heart, not her physical one, but her real heart, the seat of her soul and the core of her identity, is deeply damaged as yours was. Without a heart transplant, she will surely die. But there's great hope, the pastor continues. Our Lord has promised to give your child his very own heart, just as he gave it to you and to me. Let's schedule It's baptism for next Sunday, shall we? You sit there, reeling with questions. My beautiful baby, deeply damaged with my heart? Why didn't my parents tell me? Heart transplant? What are you talking about? Isn't there something less radical for me? Our real heart? What's going on? The pastor patiently answers your questions. If our physical heart is wounded and clogged, it affects the whole body, doesn't it? If it fails, the whole body dies. And in the meantime, before the transplant, you're in bondage. You're a slave to pain, to the terrible limitations enforced by the heart that is not working right. And without a transplant, you die in that bondage. And sin is like that. It's like terrible heart disease of the soul. It keeps us in bondage. We keep on hurting ourselves and one another. And we anger and grieve God by doing that. Even if we want to live healthy, sinless lives, we couldn't. Just as when you have a failing heart, even giving up smoking, eating right, and mild exercise only postpones the inevitable. Without a real heart transplant, you're doomed to die in the bondage of sin. But my baby, you say, she hasn't lived long enough to sin. Is she born with this? The pastor nods gently. It's like being born with a real terrible heart defect. Even though she's being fed the best baby food and getting all her shots and seeming healthy, she could have a condition that is life-threatening, right? Well, that's the human condition, there in the depth of what makes us human. Following God's laws and commandments alleviates the worst of the side effects, but it only postpones the inevitable. Only a heart transplant from God can correct it. After all, since we're all in the same boat, who else could do it? You think hard for several minutes. With a regular heart transplant, you're still the old same self, just healthier. You don't change colors or religion or gender because of it. What about this baptismal transplant you're talking about? Ah, the pastor beams, that's the big surprise. Jesus put his own heart in us. He died under sin's load, and he rose again and is forever immune to its deadly effects. His heart is completely in tune with his heavenly Father. God's intentions are engraved on Jesus' heart. He is the heart of God's beloved Son. And when we receive it, we're not only set free from slavery to sin and death, we are counted as members of God's family. He knows the justice and the mercy of God deep in his heart. When we receive it, we begin to know God that same way too. We don't stay our same old selves when we get a heart transplant in baptism. We begin to be like Jesus. No, let me rephrase that. We're made part of his own body when his heart is put in us. And he will never, ever reject us as a foreign or a dangerous entity. Sin and death will never have the last word over us. We are his when we receive his heart, life and future from God's hands. Don't we need anti-rejection drugs, though, you ask, half kiddingly? I mean, this is a lot more radical than I was thinking. I mean, a physical heart transplant surgery? That's why we are given his body and blood during communion. Almost 1,900 years ago, a great saint called communion the medicine of immortality. Maybe he was more right than he knew. Being here in worship with other transplant recipients, constantly hearing what God has done that we could never do for ourselves and what he wants to do for all his people, and receiving his presence and bread and wine, his promise that we're forgiven all our attempts to reject him. That's what keeps us healthy after this great heart transplant. And we're promised that it will last not in our physical lifetime, but forever. As Jesus said, if the Son makes you free, you are free indeed, forever. Dear friends in Christ, this isn't a hypothetical conversation. It's one the Lord has with us every week and every day that we are alive. And we hear it very pointedly on Reformation Sunday. Maybe it's the deepest meaning of Reformation, that always throughout the world, the church announces that it is comprised solely of people who live with a new heart inside of them, the heart of Christ. They are alive solely through his grace. Anyone who believes this and is baptized to receive this incredible gift of God's own life will live forever as a child of God's house. For the Son makes us free, and we will be free indeed. Amen. Our sermon hymn is found on page 229. A mighty fortress is our God. 229. Living together in trust and hope, we confess our faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. May be seated, and we will continue our worship with the morning offering. We hear God's holy invitation. Be still and know that I am God. Lord Jesus Christ, through your work of atonement for us, the righteousness of God has been disclosed apart from the law. We dare not boast except in your loving and sacrificial death for our salvation. We hear God's holy invitation. Be still and know that I am God. Hear our gratitude for hospitals, laboratories, institutions of learning, for nurses and doctors and family members who attend to our needs, and for churches like this gathering where we boldly name the names of those who need your healing touch. Evangeline Neese, Jerry Vasper, Helen Hoffman, Martha Sorensen, Andrew Hoffman, Jimmy Herring, Joel Humphreys, Arlette Cole, Stacy Roberts, B. Cantu, Wesley Johnson, Jennifer Laird, Karina Ortega, Joyce Leslie, Virgil Swanberg, Betty Redford, Cody Parker, Joe Lorraine Thomas, Dorothy Gobby, Cameron Lopez, Bernice Russo, Quinn Whitfield, Adela Nuova, Eduardo Castillo, Julie Wilde, Alan Ballinger, Robert Ballinger, Roland Williams, Suzanne Reagan, Phyllis Breyer, Trisha Hines, Dolly Montoya, Susan Tate and her family, Lupe Sanchez, Mari Romeo, Chris Cruz, foster families, all members of the armed forces, all law enforcement and first responders. We lift all those who have not been named here, either out loud or in the silence of our hearts. The end. May God's healing presence give them peace and hope in their time of need. For those who have experienced your unconditional love, we thank you, gracious God. As you come to them and be their healer, hear us pray. We hear God's holy invitation. Be still and know God. Holy Spirit, inspire us with the truth that makes us free from fear, free from eternal death, and free to be your disciples of grace, love, joy, peace, and patience. We hear God's holy invitation. Be still and know that I am God. In the noise of our clamoring cities and factories, in the loud debates of opinion and politics, reform us by quieting all fears and doubts as we listen for you. We hear God's holy invitation. Be still and know that I am God. Christ our King, weeping over Jerusalem, praying for us to our Father, promising a crucified thief paradise, providing family beneath the cross for Mary, your mother, and for John, your disciple, we pray that you will care for us too. We hear God's holy invitation. Be still and know that I am God. God of peace, we pray for all people living in countries of war. We pray for all of those who fear for tomorrow, that your spirit of comfort would draw near to them. We pray for those with power over war or peace, for wisdom, discernment, and compassion to guide their decisions. Above all, we pray for all your precious children at risk and in fear that you would hold and protect them. We hear God's holy invitation. Be still and know that I am God. Heavenly Father, thank you for knitting your church together as one body in Christ. We thank you for being part of our family of churches, Lutheran congregations, and Mission for Christ. We ask that you bless and protect the work of our association staff ministers, Mike Bradley, Christian Huntley, and Julie Smith. We also celebrate and lift before you the ministry of St. Paul in Taylor, Texas, and their pastor, George Qualley. Bless their work for your kingdom's sake. We hear God's holy invitation. Be still and know that I am God. Reform us, make us your saints in this church militant, and in the life to come, make us your saints in the church triumphant. Be our one and only King. Amen. Please stand and we will sing the Lord's Prayer.
Oh,
Now may the Lord bless you and keep you, and may the Lord's face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen. Before we go into our sending hymn, I too would just like to thank everybody that put on this beautiful fall festival. I want to thank Erica and your husband and your family for all the work and all the ingenuity that you came up with. It was really wonderful. And we also need to welcome, we have a new visitor with us today by the name of Delilah. So if you get a chance, you might want to see her. She was there too, but she was spending a lot of time with Grandma. I saw too. But anyway, thank you for all you guys have done. We really appreciate it.